be with you.
And also with you.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Oh, I didn't have to tell you to do it again. I love the joy and the energy. The stone has been rolled away. The tomb is empty. Dawn has broken. Christ is among us. Alleluia. St. Paul writes, I passed on to you what I received, which is of the greatest importance, that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and that he was raised to life 3 days later. I think that deserves another alleluia. Alleluia.
My friends, please be seated. Now, this is a paschal candle. Paschal, coming from the Greek meaning Passover and being used for the word Easter in Greek, spoken by the first Christians. Every year, we have a new candle, except last year, we did not. sometimes the candle is lit in the service called the Service of the Light. And this is either after night has fallen on Saturday night, Easter Eve, or in the dark before dawn on Easter morning. It is incredible how in the darkness of an entire church building, the light of one single flame shines out. And we light this candle throughout the year at various times. It's kept alight through Easter season, because although we won't be able to get an Easter egg in the supermarket if you go tomorrow, for the church, the Easter season has just begun. And we continue that celebration of Jesus rising to new life and his presence among his people. And we continue that celebration right until Pentecost for 50 days. So every Sunday during that, this candle is lit. When a child is baptized, or when anyone is baptized, but it's the children who have to keep away from the naked flame, they're just drawn to it like moths. When someone is baptized, this is the candle we light, and then we light a candle for them to keep from this candle. As we remember Christ's promise to be the light of the world, to be light for them. And in that service I was talking about, the service of the light, the one small light shines through all the darkness of before dawn or after sunset. And then the people light their candles from it, and the light multiplies. And isn't that the story of the Christian faith from this Easter day onwards? That the light was shared among them. The original flame never grows dimmer for lighting another candle, but the light grows and grows and grows. So we're going to bless this year's candle. The other time in particular that we light a Paschal candle is when we're saying goodbye to someone. We remember that God has walked with them throughout their earthly life, and for them this is just the next step of that journey. So when our dear friend Ethel Jones is buried on Friday there at Mayfield, they'll light their Easter candle to remember that Ethel has entered into God's Easter promises, as each of us is invited to do. Now, it's a bit tricky because it's a bit ancient. So we have five nails. Now, does anyone remember the significance of the number five in the context of the cross? Any guesses? The five wounds of Christ. So we place these, remembering that even when Jesus returned to his friends, he was still marked by his suffering, but that God had brought redemption to that suffering. You see at the top here we have the Greek symbol alpha. remember that all eternity is God's, from the very beginning, from before the Big Bang to after the universe shall cease to be. God is throughout it all, Lord of all, beyond eternity. So let us pray. Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the same yesterday, today, and forever, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. All time belongs to him and all ages. To him be blessing and honour and glory and power, now and forever. Amen. And I light this candle. Pray. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds. We celebrate new life, new joy, and new possibilities. Christ alive among us. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
I invite you to stand as we sing together the Gloria.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for
prayer for today. Creator God, this is the day that you have made, a day of wonder and celebration, a day of joy and trust. Holy God, powerful God, surprising God, this is the day, the hope, this is the grace you have made. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated for our readings.
Our first reading this morning is from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts people from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This morning's Psalm 118, verses 1 to 14 to 24. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Let Israel now proclaim
that his mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song,
and has become my salvation.
The sounds of joy and deliverance
are in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord does mighty things.
The right hand of the Lord raises up.
I shall not die but live,
and proclaim the words of the Lord.
The Lord has disciplined me hard,
but he has not given me over to death.
Open me the gates of righteousness,
and I will enter and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord.
The righteous shall enter it.
I will praise you, for you answered me,
and have become my salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing,
and it is marvellous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
This morning's reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. And the heading is The Resurrection of Christ. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, or who, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. My friends, there's an internet tag on some videos on the internet called Abrupt Chaos. where cats are happily sleeping on the bed, and then one of them does that, you know, cat startle, and then all the cats. It might be abrupt chaos now, but younger folk, and I don't mean teens, Freya and Big Emily and Little Emily and William, there are 8 eggs hidden throughout the church. While we're singing the next song, could you find those 8 eggs for me? And then we'll talk. So don't open them. Find them. Don't open them. Yeah, I know, right. Aha! Oh, Des. Don't make it harder for them. So possibly, given the age of our little people, if you've spotted one near your chair, you might beckon a little person over to find that for you. As they do that, we're going to sing, "He is Lord, He is Lord." Let's stand, shall we? Emily, can you see any eggs? Because when Jesus came into Jerusalem, which
which we celebrated last Sunday in the service, they said, "He's our king, we love him, we'll follow him anywhere." But that's not quite how the story went. Little Emily, can you open this one? Can you open number four? Little Emily, what is in there? Oh, it's another Jesus cross. This one is made of wood. We remember that on Good Friday, so we celebrated that last Friday, just a few days ago, we remembered that Jesus died on a cross of wood. He left his friends. Everyone had left him alone, all said mean things about him, but he loved them right to the very end. Now, anyone recognise what this one is? What is that? It might be easier if I... Now, do you know what that is? What's that?
Bandage.
A bandage, that's right. After Jesus had died, his friends wrapped him in cloths and they laid him in a tomb, which is where you put a body. They laid him there with love, and they left him, and they had to leave him for 3 days because it was very special days for them and they couldn't do work. So that was number five, was it? Where is number six?
Number six.
Oh, great work, Fran. Can you open that for me, please? Oh, now it's a rock. Now this rock is much smaller than the rock we're talking about this morning. In front of the tomb where they laid Jesus, they put an enormous stone so that nothing could get in, no wild dogs could get in and disturb that body there. So we remember this enormous, great big rock with a little teeny tiny rock. Now number seven. Thank you, Freya. Oh, now this is very special. Have a smell of that. Does that smell beautiful? Does that smell lovely? Now what we remember this morning and what you'll hear in our gospel reading in just a moment is that Jesus' friends, some of the women who were friends with him, brought some beautiful ointments. And they went to go and visit Jesus. Now they were saying to themselves, who is going to move away that enormous stone? How can we move that? They brought beautiful things that smelled beautiful to show how much they loved him, even though they thought he was dead. Now number eight is the last part of our story for this morning. Can you open number eight for me, Freya? Nothing is in there, because when Jesus' friends got to the tomb where they thought they would find his dead body, what they found instead was the stone rolled away and the tomb empty. Now, have you eaten an Easter egg this morning? Was there something in the middle of that one? Or Emily, what about the egg you had this morning? It wasn't solid all the way through, was it?
Mine wasn't solid all the way.
Oh, Freya's wasn't solid either. It was hollow like that egg. Yeah. And chocolate Easter eggs. If they're hollow, as opposed to if they've got caramel.
Mine was hollow.
Yours was hollow. Fantastic. Very Easter. The hollow ones remind us that the tomb was empty. Jesus had risen. And then over the next weeks, we hear the stories about how he came back to his friends who had missed him so much. Well, I think a round of applause for our wonderful announcement. You head back to play. Emily, can you take William's hand and help him go back to play? Haven't they?
they done well. Now that we've had a reminder, we're going to hear our gospel reading for this morning, which tells us the last portion of that story, which we've been hearing over our entire lives, but which we're particularly bringing to our mind this last week gone. I invite you to stand as we welcome our gospel. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early, on the first day of the week when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man, dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. For the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be ever acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Now, it's a very unsatisfying gospel, isn't it? we expect the gospel to end with the resurrection of Christ, and it is one of the enduring questions of Christian scripture. Why on earth does this gospel end in this way? In fact, if you look in your Bible, many Bibles will have sort of the portion we read and then a shorter ending of Mark and the longer ending of Mark. And ancient manuscripts simply don't agree on which one of those there is. But there's a principle which is the most difficult reading. It is probably the right one because people later try to smooth over the difficulties and make it a bit easier to read. It's even harder in the Greek. It finishes in the middle of a sentence. It finishes on the word because. The word ger, G-E-R in English. They told no one. They were afraid because. But we know the story doesn't end there. We know the women can't have kept silent, because how would we be sitting here on the other side of the world from Jerusalem 2,000 years later celebrating Christ's resurrection? We couldn't be. They must not have kept silent permanently. But that shocked silence on which the gospel ends is very human, very understandable. And it's a reminder to us that those first disciples were like us. We sometimes think of them as a different breed, able to do things that we just wouldn't be capable of. And no, they weren't. They were perfectly ordinary, just like us, with all of our, fears and doubts all of our courage, all of our joy, all of our desire to bless the world. We have this peculiar end. Now, some people say things like, maybe he got interrupted in the middle of a sentence. You know, maybe he died and couldn't, you know, literally in the middle of a sentence and couldn't finish a gospel. I think it's a deliberate choice. And I think it's a deliberate choice for a number of reasons. One delightful image I sort of heard this week. Now, remember that in the time of Jesus, they didn't have books. They had scrolls. This one is baking paper. But you'd sort of roll the scroll to the bit of scripture you were reading, and you read that portion, then you'd roll it back up again. Yeah, so you'd sort of slide along. What if we think of the Gospel of Mark as continuing? What if we think that, you know, when we begin, when we end, we begin again? You know, what if we go from, so they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Because that's it, isn't it? You know, the gospel writer leaves this space for the rest of the Christian story. Because Jesus' story hasn't finished being written yet. Jesus' story is being written by all of us. It's particularly beautiful that, you know, as I prepared to say, you know, Jesus' story is being written by all of us all the time. You might wonder what these little baskets are beside the beautiful arrangement of flowers. They're gift bags for people who go into hospital unexpectedly. It's got the things that they need, you know, and I can't, you know, somebody's landed in hospital suddenly a few times, you know, thanks Emily and William. You know, I can't tell you how much that so-called small gesture of love and care, of concern and practical help, that is part of the story of Jesus, which is being written by each of us every day in a myriad of ways. So too, not only is the story of God not yet finished being written, also consider the enormous faith in which those women travel. You know, so it's literally the first moment that they're able to do this. We've been talking recently about how unsafe it is for women to be walking at dark, you know, which shouldn't change women's behaviour but change the behaviour of others. How much more so for these women going out before it's even dawn? You know, just last night, you know, I didn't leave my house and do something because I thought, I don't quite like the idea of being out there by myself. But there they go, not even knowing how the stone is to be rolled away. Can you imagine? You know, so there they are. They've got all the things, some of which are quite expensive. They've gone out, you know, in a relatively unsafe sort of situation in faith that somehow this stone will be rolled away and they can do what they are there to do. And what they think they are there to do is to anoint the body of Jesus. What God knows they are there to do is to be the first apostles. Apostles means, you know, one who hands on the message. You know, as Paul is writing in that letter from the Corinthians we heard this morning, they're the ones who proclaim the message first to the other apostles. Mary Magdalene is sometimes called the apostle to the apostles because she tells them what they need to know about the good news of Christ. So we are writing the story of Jesus still now. We are writing how he is affecting the world around us through how we affect the world around us. And just like those women did, we too are going to step out in faith in that. We do every day, even when we don't recognise it. We're going to step out in faith that what God is calling us to, he will give us the gifts and talents we need. That the stones that we cannot roll away ourselves, that stand in our way, he will roll away. That his good news will be heard across the whole world. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
My friends, now we come to a renewal of baptismal vows. Now, some folk here aren't baptised, but many folk have been. And for some folk, that was a while ago. So every year, you know, just as we remember all the time that God is constantly making new, God is constantly bringing new life to us. So every year at Easter, we remember how God renews his promises to us and we renew our promises to him. So as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, we remember that through his death and resurrection, we have died to sin, been buried with him in baptism, and now rise with him to a new life within the family of his church. I therefore invite you, if you wish, to stand and to join with me in renewing our affirmation of faith and our allegiance to Christ. Do you turn to Christ?
I turn to Christ.
Do you repent of your sins?
I repent of my sins.
Do you renounce evil?
I renounce evil.
The Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness and make you walk in light and obedience of Christ. I now ask you to make the profession of Christian faith in which you are baptized and in which you live and grow. Do you believe and trust in God the Father who made the world?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Holy Spirit? Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humanity?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God?
I believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I ask you, will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship in the breaking of bread and prayers?
I will, Christ.
Will you persevere in resisting evil? And whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all people, loving your neighbour as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all, and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Almighty God, we thank you for our fellowship in the household of faith with all those who have been baptised in your name. Keep us faithful to our baptism, and so make us ready for that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, my friends, prepare to get sprinkled. Now, we have here the waters of baptism, and as we sprinkle them, we remember the freshness of new life that God brings. Now, I'm going to have to be far more cautious than I'm accustomed to being, so that I don't get our opinion. Oops. mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of our dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to the Lord's table. So let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. We are the body of Christ. His Spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I invite you to turn to the people near you and offer them a sign of peace. Now, friends, during this next hymn, the offertory is going to be brought forward to the church, brought forward to the sanctuary. So if you haven't had an opportunity to place your offertory, I'm afraid this is your last chance. So you might, we'll sing our hymn, "This is the day that the Lord has made."
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is This is the day, this is the day when he rose again, when he rose again. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day when the Spirit came, when the Spirit came. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it.
This is the day when the Spirit came.
We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day when the Spirit came.
My dear friends, as we join in gladness and thanksgiving, we are united with all those who have entered into their eternal reward. And today in particular, we remember with gratitude John Dawson and Ethel Jones,
As we gather, we pray for those who are missing them today. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Loving God, we thank you for this world of wonder and delight. You have given it to us to care for, so that all your creatures may enjoy its bounty. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that when we turned away from you, you sent Jesus to live and work as one of us and bring us back to you. He showed us how to love you and set us free to love and serve one another. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that on the cross Jesus took away our sin, all that keeps us from each other and from you. He frees us from hate and fear, from all that destroys love and trust. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. And so with everyone who believes in you, with all the saints and angels, we rejoice and praise you, singing together. Thank you for these gifts of bread and wine. And we pray that we who eat and receive that we who receive them, as Jesus said, may share his body and his blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." On the night after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He shared the cup with them and said, "This is my blood poured out so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ
will come again. It has been so long since we have been able to sing, hasn't it? You have gathered us together, O God, to feed on Christ and to remember all he has done for us. Fill us with your spirit, that we may follow Jesus in all we do and say, working for justice and bringing your peace to this world that you have made, accept our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Blessing and honor, glory and power are yours.
Many are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
Jesus, Redeemer of the world.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. This is the Lord's table. Come.
Come on, honey. You know better, darling. There are candles up here. It's not safe, honey.
The body of
my friends, there are some great blessings of being a priest. Among them is always getting your favourite hymns. So I'm afraid we're going to sing my favourite hymn now, and my deep apologies if you don't know it, but hopefully, even if you don't know it, the beautiful imagery of this will be another lens with which to view this wonderful Easter day. Thank you, Chris.
Spring.
Christians throughout the world, in so many different countries, in so many different places over the centuries, have prayed together and celebrated this holy day. I invite you to pray the Lord's Prayer in the language your heart knows it best. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, it's very important. Those ones are hollow. I made sure they were the right kind. Friends, many of you have heard of the passing or of Ethel Jones, who, with her lovely husband Jack, for many years was a parishioner here. Over the last years, she's been resident in a facility and received ministry there. And in fact, Reverend Daphne was with her, very close to the end. Her funeral service is this Friday at 1 p.m, but it isn't here. It's at St Andrew's Mayfield. Now, Ethel and Jack were married there, and she's going home to Jack now from the same place. But even more significantly than that, St Andrew's Mayfield can hold 100 under current rules. We can hold 60. The immediate family, just the immediate descendants, added up to 54. I think her son was saying, it must have been 56, because he said, could you imagine choosing the only four friends of Ethel's to be able to attend the service if they'd held it here? So you're invited to St Andrew's Mayfield to celebrate her life and send her home 1 p.m. this coming Friday. I want to offer my deep gratitude for the beautiful flowers, and isn't it just lovely having flowers in the church again, for all those who have cleaned, who have prepared, who have ensured that everything has been just so lovely this morning. And of particular note this morning, honestly, I could not have done from Thursday night through to now, let alone the rest of it, without Chris Lewis. I am so grateful. For those who don't know, Des and Rob, got the technology working, but it's Chris that week by week makes it so that we can read the prayers, for which we are so grateful, as well as our wonderful music this morning. Now, an absolute joy, we're going to bless these gifts for those who find themselves in hospital. Holy God, you know the path of our lives, but sometimes it is a mystery to us. We pray for those who are suddenly caught out, who are struck down by unexpected sickness or injury, by those who suddenly have all their plans upended by ill health. We pray your blessing upon them. We pray for healing for them. Above all, we pray that they may know your love and your strength through
through all the trials they face. May these gifts be for these folk a sign of your loving care and of the care of us here. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Reverend Daphne, you know, retirement's a very strong word for somebody who continues to minister so faithfully and so constantly. Reverend Daphne will take those to the folk who need them for us. Shall we stand, my friends, as we pray our final prayer and then ask for God's blessing? Let us pray together. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. We ask for God's blessing upon us as we go about our day. Now, I should say, we're not actually doing refreshments this morning, partly because I felt everyone has other plans. Everyone is going on to celebrate this wonderful day and how beautiful it is to celebrate with other dear ones. So we take that blessing with us as we go. Almighty God, who redeemed us through the resurrection of Christ, who raised us to newness of life through the waters of baptism and has brought us out of slavery into everlasting freedom, give you joy and peace in faith and bring you to your eternal inheritance. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and the ones we love, today and always. As we go, we'll sing, "Yours be the glory."